You're watching Chicago's very own WGN News with Larry Potash, Robin Baumgarten, Paul Conrad, Pat Tomasulo, Anna Belleval, and Courtney Hall. This is WGN Morning News at 9.
Great.
Welcome back. Coming up this half hour, live music from the Houston soul band, The Suffers.
Plus, Pat and Mike are going to answer your text messages. They'll share them with you. But first,
well, he has been a part of one of the biggest rock bands of our time for 36 years. Journey keyboardist, hit songwriter, and Rock and Roll Hall of Fame inductee Jonathan Cain is the first band member to share his memoir, which includes behind-the-scenes stories.
The book is called Don't Stop Believin', The Man, The Band, and the Song That Inspired Generations. And he's the guy that's got one of the most iconic keyboard starts to a song, and that's you.
That's me.
God.
We DJs used to love to talk over that intro. It's a nice long intro.
It's a nice long intro.
To talk over.
It was Steve's idea. You know, yeah. Steve, I had the chords of the chorus I brought in originally. I brought the chorus. That's all I had. He said, those chords are perfect. Now, just do that rolling Jonathan Cain thing, you know. Mm-hmm. Like this, Steve? Yeah, like that. And then, of course, Neil, you know, being Mr. Genius, comes up with the bass line. So I just said, I'm taking that. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Well, what I never realized is that Steve was like a pop guy and Neil was like a rock guy, and you were kind of bringing it all together. Well, what was it? Talk about your role and what it was like to hear a Journey song on the radio for the first time.
You know, I was in the Babies first, right?
Yeah,
and the reason I got into Journey was because they saw me play as the opening act. I never even auditioned for the band. They were thrilled that I could play guitar, I could write, I could sing backgrounds. And they liked our album, Union Jack. So they called me and said, our keyboard player is going to retire and start a family, and you're it. I'm like, okay.
Wow.
So I had seen the band, you know, play like some 50 shows, right? They were doing the Capture Tour where they recorded a live album in Detroit. So long story short, I knew the prowess of Steve. I knew the virtuosity of Neil. I mean, one of the most incredible guitar players.
Yeah.
I was surrounded by greatness.
Yeah.
They were great. And the creative process was Steve wanted to sing this kind of soulful pop music, and Neil wanted to, you know, more prog rock, mm-hmm. you know. And it was just putting those things together. So Neil would give me these cassette tapes of all of his ideas. And I would go through them, I'd mark them, and, you know, and then bring them into a rehearsal and say, Steve, how about this, yeah. you know. And I really married Neil's musicality into that voice. And all of a sudden, it was just a matter of putting these two great things together. Mm-hmm. You know? So I felt like I was kind of a bridge.
He said that the actual phrase, don't stop believing, was inspired because your dad used to say that.
My father, that was his prayer for me. You know, when I was going to quit and come home to Chicago, I was in Hollywood mm-hmm. trying to make it with Wolfman Jack and the management company. And he said, no, don't stop believing. So I wrote it down in a notebook in the book, it's, you know, pretty laid out. It's in the book, I call it the journey, my journey to journey, really. And, you know, it was just sitting in my notebook. And I said, Steve Perry would sing this.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So that's how it worked.
You talk about growing up in Chicago. We were showing some pictures of you when you were young. I was absolutely stunned when I read that you went to Our Lady of the Angels, and you were at that school, that horrific fire that was 60 years ago this December. Can you describe? I can't even imagine. You were on the first floor.
And I got out first. I was probably the second class. And Sister Mary Superior, Sister Mary Florence, was there subbing for our teacher, Sister Mary Edgar, who was sick that day. And she quietly took us outside. You know, one of the teachers said, smoke, I smell smoke. And it was one of those fires that you didn't really know was going on because it started from the roof. And what happened was it was arson, and somebody had set a bin of paper on fire with a cold intake pipe right there. So all of the heat and the smoke from the bin went up to the roof. So the school burned from the top down. And ironically, the only way the firemen could put out that fire was with the new fire truck Commissioner Quinn had come up with, called the snorkel truck. So he shows up with this giant crane, and they put out the fire in about 5 minutes. Oh. But it's too late. But it's too late. We think, you know, I heard the roof cave in. I heard the screams. There was 73 children in one room that died.
How does that impact you for the rest of your life and your family?
I'll tell you, the Bible says out of pain something new is born. And my father planted a seed that day and said, you were saved for a reason. You know, and in the book, I describe the trauma, you know, that we all went through. We didn't have much time. We didn't have any grief counseling. We weren't even allowed to talk about it. We were whisked off on buses to satellite schools the next week. Mm-hmm. You know, that was it. But my dad said, you were saved for a reason, John. And he prophesied greatness in music. He said, I'm going to give you music lessons. So he took me to this school, music school, American School of Music. I was this little kid, little tiny 8-year-old. I mean, I didn't grow until I was in high school. Mm-hmm. I grew 9 inches in high school.
Wow.
So I couldn't, he put my hands around the guitar and pianos were too big. And they put this little accordion on me and I'm like, this is perfect, Dad. So I rocked that accordion for years, you know, and it did my, well, in, you know, in the, I talk about just how it became so important to move on.
Yeah.
You know, music became my salvation. And I actually went to Washington, D.C. to lobby for music in schools. And mm-hmm. I told a story of how it kind of saved my soul in a way. And it was my escape. In the book, I speak about escaping many things mm-hmm. and moving on. And I end up making my biggest album called Escape.
Yeah. Is, you had a, you had
pretty
a
funny.
Chance Encounter when you went out to L.A. You bump into young filmmaker George Lucas and young actor Ron Howard, who
amazing.
They were making American Graffiti.
Well, I think God was putting me around greatness all the time. He'd show me this is great. This is what great looks like.
Yeah.
This is what great sounds like.
But you went right up to them, though, right?
I was right
at.
I was
no
sitting
hesitation.
Next to Harrison Ford.
Wow.
Young Harrison Ford. And I had no idea, you know, I'd seen the movie and I was, you know, I remember he was just very cool guy. And little did I know all these people were going to be great, you know, stars, you know, but it was God showing me, even Wolfman Jack was a star, you know, in his own right. And it was interesting that he would let me go to these tapings, my brother and I, we hadn't made it yet. And yet I end up hosting Midnight Special as the babies, in the babies. The band hosted Midnight Special with Wolfman. So 3 years later, boom, I'm right where I'm supposed to be, you know. I remember going to see the Eagles at the Forum. 3 years later, I'm headlining the Forum with Journey.
Wow.
And for sellout nights, by the way.
Journey fans want to know, maybe diehard fans know this, but what was the deal with Steve Perry? Did he just run his vocal cords into the ground? Was it the stress of success? Was it a combination of those things?
Well, you know, in the book, I lay it out the way I saw it, you know, and this is certainly not a Journey official, you know, book. It was my take on what I saw and what I, you know, heard and what I understood. And, you know, success and fame can really be intrusive in your life. And it's the road can wear you down big time. And I think it all culminated, it just all was a combination of all of that. We worked very hard. We went, those years, I think from 81 to 84, we did 2 albums and I don't know how many, 4 tours or something. Way too many shows. Way too many shows for one band.
And it just
with that voice
toll?
Too. Yeah. With that voice, with the way, and he seemed like it was effortless, and it was.
Yeah.
And then it began to take its toll, you know, that it's just like too much. And I think he said, I'm done, you know. And there was certain circumstances that I explained in the book that unforeseen. A lot of people don't know that, you know, were threatening his life and his sanity. And he chose life, which I commend him for. He was a wonderful son to his mother, devoted son.
And that's
when
a
his
great
mother
thing.
Got sick.
Yeah.
It was unbelievable to watch him go through it. It was so hard to watch my friend, you know, watch his mother wither away. You know, it's very difficult.
Yeah, it's a book not just about music, but about life.
Life
it's
happens.
A great, it's a great read.
Yeah, so life happens, you know, and I don't care if you make, you know, $250 a week or $1 million, it happens.
Yeah.
And how do you deal with it? And I hope that dads read it and get inspired, and you know, encourage their kids, you know, to recognize the greatness and uniqueness of your kid.
Yeah. It's great to meet you. You got to come back
great
again. Come on now.
Stop believing. Book
Go
signing.
Cubs.
Yeah.
Book signing is tonight at 2nd and Charles at Westridge Court in Naperville. You can get tickets in advance, which includes an autographed copy of the book. Go to jonathancain.eventbrite.com for more information. John, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So great to meet you.
Thank you.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Hey, man.
Thanks.
See, being surrounded by greatness is something I don't know anything about. One of these days, Larry.
You can take her with you.
Hey, Morgan.
Hey,